So verse 25. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and he would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering to his father's entreatment, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time. So that's pretty good. The guy never, ever did anything wrong, ever. He has every right to be upset. thy commandment, and yet, thou never gavest me all this good that I've done, and you never gave to me, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. Okay, so I want to read a little statement that I made on waste. The elder son saw the extreme response of the father toward a harlot son as waste. The lavish party, the extreme rejoicing and merriment, the money that was wasted, the fatted calf that could have been sacrificed for the poor and needy, or for the acknowledgement of the elder who had made his ministry the superior choice as a way of pleasing the father. That's a lot of stuff packed into one angry person. and there's obviously a lot more. I didn't want to go full into the elder son's heart for fear that I'd be drug into the dark hole. So he responds towards the father that way, and he responds towards the prodigal in that way. It's similar to, and hopefully we'll get to it in this go-round, Mary Bethany and the disciples, and their response was, you know, this is just waste. You know, the Pharisees looking at the rejects, as they in their minds, that are with Jesus, and Jesus hanging with them, you know, that feel of being with them, and not with the Pharisees and all of this, you know. And we've been good. You know, we have been good, and they haven't, and this is the way you know. So, in verse 1 and 2 then, why did the Pharisees murmur? Well, they did it because they didn't see anything of worth in the tax collectors and sinners. And they didn't, therefore, they saw the response of the Lord as inappropriate to what the real situation was, but it wasn't the real situation. It wasn't the real situation. Elder son mind, it's scary. Can I get an amen? It's scary. It is scary. Okay. So then you have the tax collectors and the sinners. For whatever they've ever done wrong, they have come for Jesus. You know, you got to see that, because that's worth something. And the Pharisees clearly were not there for Jesus. They were ready to find fault with him and with them and whatever else. So in my opinion, this is my opinion, Jesus saw less in the Pharisees than he did in the tax collectors and sinners. But they had spent their whole life trying to please God, trying to fit into his ways and means, which were commandments and all this kind of stuff. And Jesus, like the elder son and the father, looking at him and going, you know, this is not what I want. This is so far from what I want. And even when I entreat you, you respond very harshly back to me when I'm out here trying to bring you in. And you have to remember that. The Father or the Lord is always trying to bring us in. I'm sorry. He's always trying to bring us in. It is His heart. I've shared several times on waiting on oneness. Jesus is waiting on oneness. He's not waiting on us to reach a certain spiritual level of knowledge that will just impress everybody. He's waiting on oneness, and that's a big deal to His heart. But if you only hear that, me or anyone else here that teaches that, says those words, you're not going to get it, because Him waiting on oneness means absolutely nothing unless you see it as from His heart. Because then you realize this involves something that the Eternal has wanted from the very beginning. And we're fooling around playing with kid toys. You understand what I mean? And I don't mean that what you do isn't important and da-da-da-da or me in comparison to what's in the Lord's heart. We have to say that. We have to. It's so, so petty compared to what's really what He would like to get out of it. Okay, so Jesus sees a bigger problem with the Pharisees, and He does because of their view, because it is based on right and wrong. It's based on the knowledge of good and evil. And the knowledge of good and evil, folks, is always based on the earth. I mean, that's a big point. You know, if we're so enthralled in the earth that we get upset with the Father, or we get upset with the Son, or we get upset with the prodigal that may not no longer be the prodigal, it may actually be the Son, it's because our views are so messed up that we cannot perceive reality. But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil gave us another reality. And it's not God's reality. Therefore, that's where you have to say, therefore, it's not reality. Because it's not God's reality. It's our earthly reality, and we're still eating in that tree. See? And I keep waiting for one day somebody to just fall backward in their chair when I say that we still keep eating of the same tree, like on a daily basis, like all the time, you know, throughout the day, judging and looking and viewing and usually within that is we're the sun, not S-O-N, but S-U-N, and everything goes around us, and if it doesn't work out or make me happy or make me comfortable or make me feel loved or make me da-da-da-da, if something happens that makes something negative towards me, then I have to react, not with Christ. Okay, but no, that's not true. I don't have to, see. But you have to as long as that's your government. You have to, and you will. You will. And you'll keep judging that way. So, you know, it's like, but I mean, the reason why I said fall back in our chair is that it's like, my God, you know, I have stood there and looked at Adam and Eve and said, well, if I was in the garden, I wouldn't have eaten of that tree. You know, I wouldn't have done that and brought down the whole ruin. We're bringing down the whole ruin of our world by continually eating of it and then looking with eyes that, you see what I mean? It's like you eat it, get it in you, and then you look with those eyes. And that's, look at how horrible the elder son is. Now, I will say this. We're eventually, I guess I can say it now. We haven't even started with the prodigal son story. I haven't even got to the bridge yet. And it's going to get good if the Lord allows me to keep sharing. It's going to be really good. It's going to be incredible. But everything up to this point is just to prepare our hearts. I can't even put it into words. I'm just telling you, it's just amazing. It is amazing. And I said to, you know, my wife, I said, well, you know, everybody's going to go, well, you pretty much covered the story. No, even the bridge is going to be more. It's going to explode onto the true meaning of this story, much less what's on the other side of the bridge. And I don't want to, you know, start the bridge and then get to the edge of the bridge before we go into the land and then have to stop. But I'm telling you, pray seriously, seriously, seriously. What if this really could be something that the Lord really wanted to happen? I just want to be with Him. I don't have an agenda, but like he's just, anyway, I'm very excited for every one of us. All right. And let me say this too. I was going to mention this also. When we get into the second half, and especially the bridge, just to even things out, we're going to see how extremely terrible the prodigal son is. Extremely. Okay? Just to even things out, because we talked for a while on the elder. We need to see the real issues, and the real issues are powerful and powerfully bad when we realize what's going on in this story. So I say that for those of you who are taking refuge in being more prodigal-like. You know, we all need Jesus. Come on. We all need Him. And the, you know, let the things, you know, somebody says, I don't want to be in condemnation. Let Him beat me down until I just say, I only want Jesus. You know, let it happen. Instead of fighting off, I'm fighting off condemnation. You know? Well, that's your purpose in life, isn't it? Fight off condemnation. No. To seek the Lord, to be changed into that same image from glory to glory. Hallelujah. Yes. All right, so back to the elder son. So the elder son, he does what he does. You know, it's not fair. It's, you know, I deserve better than him. You know, or the father is deceived by the prodigal son. Or it goes so far. You know, the father is favoring the prodigal when I can't believe this. Believe it. That's your mind working. The father is not favoring the prodigal. He's favoring the son. He's his son. That's who he favors. He always will. And as long as we're making it, you know, elder son and younger son, we got problems. When we make it the son, things will start exploding in a good way. All right. So Jesus says, you know, Jesus hears the Pharisees, you know. He hears the Pharisees talking, you know, and saying, well, you know, he's hanging out with these, you know, tax collectors and sinners and, you know, and I'm sure, you know, and Jesus goes, okay, and then he starts telling this story. I'm sure the disciples heard what Jesus said, right? So we got the Pharisees, elder son, disciple, and harlot. And the disciples hear Jesus' words, and they may have started pointing fingers at the Pharisees. Those guys, you see what they're doing? You know, and all we're doing is hanging out with Jesus, and, you know, all right? So they will do that, you know why? Because they think they're more in tune with Jesus than the Pharisees. Okay? They do. See, this thing is a vicious cycle. That's why none of us shall escape, you know. We don't. It's just the way it's ordered that way, because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. That's why we don't escape. So sometime later, and you find this in Matthew 26. Verse 7 through 13, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box, a very precious ointment, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples, here's the list, the disciples saw it, they had indignation. Who's that sound like? It does, see? And they're the disciples. And they're the ones listening and pointing fingers at the Pharisees. this gets bad. I'm telling you, we need the Lord. Okay, when they saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this prodigal? See the word waste? For this ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me. For ye have the poor always with you, but ye have not me always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this and that this woman hath done be told for a memorial of her. So if I said, well, how many of you think you really understand memorial ministry? Which I won't. I don't want to see any hands. I'd like to go home feeling pretty good. It doesn't matter. Seek the Lord. Come on. Guess what? I just told you what memorial ministry was. But anyway, putting the Lord first, making that your emphasis. Jesus said, this woman hath wrought a good work upon me. And when I was in my office, I looked this up on the Amplified Bible. I really liked it. A good work, a noble, a praiseworthy, a beautiful. And I went, oh my God, it's covering all the bases. Noble in that it came from something that wasn't tainted with self. You know what I mean? Praiseworthy in that the Lord, the Father even, would say, this is good stuff. And beautiful because it was beautiful to his heart. Wow. All right. So I wrote, like the Pharisees, and the elder son, okay, the disciples are about to join the ranks of this Pharisee and elder son spirit. I mean, could this be discouraging for Jesus? So like the Pharisee and the elder son before them, they complained about waste. So I wrote, if you don't see the Father's heart for his son, your judgments will be wrong, period. If you don't see the Father's heart for his son, our judgments are wrong. We should start from that point. You know, his ways are not my ways, except for I'm pretty good. You know, his thoughts are not my thoughts, except for I've got some really good thoughts. You know, when is the scripture ever going to, excuse my wording, attack us, attack our minds, attack our thoughts? When is it going to be like white blood cells that start attacking these germs that infect us with our thoughts and our ways? And it confronts us. We go, instead of just, yeah, amen, and then continue to be what we are, but with this longing, but I really want you, Lord. Longing gets you nothing. No, I mean, you can long for something all day long. Remember the dress in the window and the girl walking by every day longing for it? Until you buy it, until you say, I buy this. This is the truth. Buy the truth and sell it not. That's the scripture. All right, so if you don't see the Father's heart for his son, your judgments will be wrong. You will judge by the wrong tree, not by the cross. Wrong tree. Judging by the cross is the right tree. The judgment of the cross put us all to death. The judgment of the cross condemned us all. Did you know that? It condemned us all. So why are we fighting condemnation? You see what I mean? I mean, if it did, then be condemned and let the Son be what he is. But we're preserving. I want to keep this little part of me alive, you know. I'm almost dead. You know, this is a picture I saw years ago when I was in Bible school that we would say, oh, I'm dead with Christ. But really, we're like, not in the house, we're in the screen porch in the backyard in there laying on our deathbed going, I'm dead with Christ. And, you know, and the Lord's going, you're not dead. No, I'm almost dead. I'm barely hanging on. You're still you. Just let go. You know, this class may go just a little longer because, but when my mother passed away, they sent her home from the hospital, and they said, well, she might as well die at home with the family. So I have three brothers and two sisters, so we were all gathered around in the house, and my youngest sister was right there beside her bed just the whole time, and then, of course, the rest of the family as much as possible. And, you know, I sat in the living room, and I just wanted to be with the Lord and hear from the Lord for her. And she was like in a coma. She was just fighting, not dying. She was wrestling. I mean, you could literally, I mean, it was a very real thing. Wrestling and just, you know, afraid to let go and all this kind of stuff. And so hours and hours and hours passed. And finally, my youngest sister got up and went to the bathroom. And when she did, my other brother and one of the other brothers also, and Mom was alone. And so I went in there and I just sat down and just took her hand. And I said, Mom, you don't have to worry. This isn't about you. It's not about how good you were. And she had a rough life, you know, this and that. This is about Jesus. This is about loving Jesus still. It's about loving Jesus and wanting to be with him. And so I just said, your sins are washed away. And so I just started singing, oh, the blood of Jesus washes white as snow. And I just, as I was singing it, her breathing just calmed. She's in a coma, but her spirit's still alive, you know. And it just calmed down. It got so calm and everything. And then I just said, Mom, you can let go. You can go be with the Lord. She just let go. And if ever there was a picture of someone passing on into the arms of the Lord, that was it. And you can't imagine how comforting that was for me. Because I know what happened, you know. We were talking about the screened-in back porch and, you know, still alive. Just let go. And I'll tell you, when I was in Bible school, my first experience with understanding the death of Christ required me to let go of myself, of my this and that. And it's probably the hardest thing to do in the whole world because of our survival thing. But if you can imagine finding defenses for not letting go, because we don't, you know, or finding excuses for our flesh instead of the cross. See, remember, we're talking about the tree, you know. They go by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, when we should go by the cross and the tree, that tree. And that tree settles it in a glorious way, because here was the thing: when I first experienced any form of reality of death was I let go. And when I did, I found out, and this blew my mind. Now, I know it's going to sound dumb. You're going to go, are you stupid? You didn't know this? I totally forgot about resurrection. And that he was the resurrection. Because, you know, I'd so thoroughly said, I am letting go. That when, you know, his life started coming forth, I just went, oh, my God, I forgot about this. I wasn't counting on it. I was, I'm trying to just impart this word noble. There was no slimy motives behind it. You know, just, okay. This is it. This is what has to happen. And just, and then Jesus begins to come forth, and it's a whole lifetime of that. All right. So, as long as you retain that knowledge, God will intentionally keep you from eating of the tree of life. true. Okay, that's scary. He drove Adam and Eve out. And then he put an angel with a sharp sword to stand in the way of the tree of life. Because you can't eat both. One of them is so self-centered, and the other one is so not self-centered. Right? And one of them is self-protecting and the other one is self-giving to the max. So it's not that we eradicate it out of ourselves. That's not what we're talking about. As long as we are okay with it and we don't make a stand and we don't say, Lord, this is shameful to me. This shows me for the worst. You know, I am no longer worthy to be called thy son or say that thy son lives in me. Or you know what I'm saying? Okay, well, that's the worst everybody wants. I don't want to go there. I don't want to go. That's where you have to go. That is where you have to go. You do. But it starts with saying, I hate this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And I hate this whatever in me that treats it as if it's valid information, valid views. View, that's a good, it validates the view of this, but it's a false world in God's world. It's a false, as horribly opposite. And you see that with the father and the elder son out there. We'll see it with the prodigal too. But up to this point, you see it with the father and the son and the horrible reaction and treatment and the things said to the father, absolutely not knowing his heart for the son, not even that aware, just I see your heart towards the prodigal and you threw this party for him and you never did. Because see, that's an accusation against the father. You never, me, and yet I underline the different words there. It's powerful. It is powerful. And that's kind of like the elder son. That was his opportunity to come to himself and say, this is a hog pen too. This is a horrible hog pen that I have made for myself. It's nasty. It's mean. It's ugly. It's mean-spirited. It is filled with self. And I'm adding stuff here, although, well, let me just say this. Maybe he could have, after saying all that, maybe he could have looked into the father's face, into his eyes, and seen the hurt, and seen the failure that the father must have felt with his son, that maybe the father felt he failed. You know, that sounds like him, you know, take the blame. And maybe the elder could have looked and said, wait, Father, explain something in your eyes and in your heart that I've never seen. So there is value in hurting the Father, in hurting the Lord, if we can see. You understand what I'm saying? If we can see how it affects him, because it might open the door to his heart. It might open the door to his heart. And again, I think that's part of what happened with the prodigal. I'm no more worthy, you know. Well, that's basically it. I'll just reread those last two statements. As long as you retain that knowledge, God will intentionally keep you from eating of the tree of life. There is no prayer. There is no altar call. There is no circumstance that's going to do this. It's going to have to be, I reject, even if you can't stop it. You understand? You have to recognize it for its ugliness and say, I reject it. You ever done that? Anybody ever done that on like dealing with demons or something? I renounce you in the name of Jesus. Well, you didn't do that because you were holy and pure. You know, it wasn't based on you being right that you could renounce it. Well, you know, how about I renounce these thoughts, Satan? Okay, well, we're pretty strong in renouncing the thoughts that Satan gives us. How about we renounce our thoughts and those attitudes? And ask the Lord, catch me when I'm, you know, remind me after I've done it. Catch me when I'm in the middle of it. Catch me beforehand. Start a new way of dealing with me, Father. Start a new way. Deal with me now by the Son. Can't go wrong. Now, seriously, you cannot go wrong because that'll never change. That's eternal. You step into that role and you're in with the Father because you want the Son more than you want you. You step in there still wanting you. You're like trying to invade the Garden of Eden. You know, trying to get back in without denying that other. Okay, Father, we just thank you and we love you. We love you. We do. We love you, but we don't even know you. I mean, in a real sense, we don't know the complete and absolute dedication you have to your Son. And that's why, and yes, we're included, but we're only included in the Son. That's where you included us. And it wasn't based on anything of us except for our union into him and our identification. So we say, not our mind, not our will, not I, all of that. Not my mind, not my will, not I. And we say, that those are all scriptures, Father. Make it the living word inside of us that we will dedicate ourselves toward this end instead of spending our time fighting for moments and crumbs that fall from the table. We could actually sit there at the table in fellowship and feast with you like the prodigal was doing over the things that you enjoy feasting on. Lord, we ask you to do it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Love you guys. Oh, by the way, I guess I shouldn't totally shut it off yet. Pharisee, elder son, disciple, or harlot? Who do you want to be? Of the four, only the harlot was truly in tune with Jesus' heart. And that's what we end up. We end up the worst. Outwardly. But inwardly, we touch his heart.